see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Welcome to the It's in Queens podcast, the only podcast that showcases the best borough in the city, the country, and the world, if I might say so myself. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons, and each week I bring you conversations with the people and the places that are part of the fabric of Queens. I'm about to take a staycation, finally. Normally this time of year, I do venture out on at least one road trip, but my suspicion really is that after being cooped up for so long, and now that school is over, much of the country has started to reopen, and so there will be a lot of people on the road. So, if you're like me, why not discover some places that are right in our backyard? And while right now, amid this heat wave, I might prefer a bit more indoor spaces so I can stay cool, I'm already thinking of taking in a few historical sites and parks and even some business districts. I want to find the perfect bagel and the perfect ice cream cone and burger, of course, burger, and even a nice shady spot where I can just relax. Don't we all want these things in summer? Independence Day is next week, and so I'm looking for a barbecue as well. So friends, hit me up. I'm open. It feels like one of those movies where they open up the hatch and we look out and discover a brand new world. Sort of like when the spaceship lands on Earth at the end of the movie WALL-E. Sorry, I spoiled that if you haven't seen it, but frankly, you should have seen that movie by now. What I'm getting at is that we have so much in our borough to do and enjoy, so why not? Why not take advantage of that? I recently mentioned that I went to a concert downtown for the first time in like 15 or 16 months, and it hit me. I started to get emotional because I'd not enjoyed anything like that live and in person in what seemed like forever. Being with people at that moment meant something. Watching them smile and laugh and applaud and even dance in the aisle, it was just so incredible. For many of us who honor the COVID health and safety recommendations, events like this now feel like rewards where we can find community once again. So as we head into the dog days of summer, I want to introduce you to the people who are going to be part of our recovery whenever I can, the cultural venues that are ready to welcome you back in person. One of those is the exceptional Queensborough Performing Arts Center, or QPAC, which has been around for more than half a century. And if you've not been there to see a performance before, I'm certain you're going to want to check them out after hearing this interview with Susan Agin, the executive and artistic director at QPAC. Susan Agin, welcome to the It's in Queens podcast.
Thank you so much. Lovely to be here.
Let's start off by talking about QPAC's history. When were you founded?
1965. So this is our 56th year in existence.
How has QPAC grown, evolved over time?
Well, let's see. Pre-pandemic, we were serving 165,000 people a year. That's a lot of people. And we broadened our reach over the years, of course, which is really exciting. We serve all of Queens and Long Island, New Jersey, Manhattan, Brooklyn, Connecticut. People come even from Pennsylvania, which is, it's really incredible that people are hearing about us and they want to see what we have to offer. What hasn't changed is the caliber of entertainment that we've been presenting. 50 years ago, we were presenting Thelonious Monk and Judy Collins, for example. And today it's Michael Bolton and Bernadette Peters, Vanessa Williams, so many wonderful international companies.
And of course, I'm very selfish here. I was last there when I saw Michelle Lee of Knott's Landing fame on your stage. Sat front row, was very excited because she even recognized me because I'm one of her Uber fans.
Oh my goodness. So that's so funny. Were you drawn to her through her television appearances, or was it, she's a big Broadway gal.
And I had seen her at Broadway Bears a few years ago. And okay. So that's why. And a friend of mine had been her publicist for a while and was very excited to be able to do that as well. So I have to say, it was wonderful stepping into your theater. Now, I do understand you're undergoing a significant renovation.
We are. You know, there's been a slight delay due to the city shutting down all of its construction projects. But now we're back in business. And the new theater will feature new box seats and accessible bathrooms, a beautiful concession, all new lighting and sound systems. It's very exciting.
I've seen that with culturals that I work with, that over this last year, when they could not have people visiting in person, they started thinking about what can we do to renovate? What can we do to prepare for the future? So I do want to go back a moment because mm-hmm. I just jumped in with my Michelle Lee anecdote, but I'm curious, you know, who some of your most memorable performers have been, some of the more memorable performances that stick out in your mind. And I know it's going to be difficult to choose any one.
Yes. And, you know, like we said, we love all our children the same, right? But, you know, they're all memorable in some way. What's interesting is when you host an entertainer, for a brief period of time, you become family. So some of them travel from far and near to be here. So you become their closest contact while they're in town. So they put their trust in you and you have to deliver. So it's interesting because if I speak about one and not the other, I feel like I'm, you know, giving preference to one child and not the other. But there's so many stories. For example, I remember when David Cassidy performed at the theater. His show sold out in 2 minutes. I mean, literally, talk about Uber fans. He had such Uber fans. You know, his fan club at one time was larger than the Beatles fan club. So it was really insane. Fans came from all over the world, from London and the Netherlands. And it was just, in fact, I remember, so funny, I haven't thought about this in a while, but I remember that when we went on sale, as I said, his show sold out in just a matter of minutes. But at the same time, we were getting phone calls from people who I can't get tickets. It won't go through. And I couldn't figure out why isn't it not going through? What's happening? What's wrong? What's not working? And I reached out to our, you know, ticketing provider and I said, look, you know, the phones are ringing off the hook. I don't know what's going on. We hadn't expected quite that kind of, you know, frenzy. And we had found out that the ticketing systems were not turned on for international sales. And so that's what was happening because so many people were buying from really all over the world. They were planning to come to the United States and see the show and stay for a few days. So it was incredible. Then of course, hearing Dionne Warwick sing all her classic hits, you know, is incredible. Watching Joan Rivers work a room, you know, when you see her in person and when she worked a room, it was just incredible. I don't know if there was anyone who worked as hard as she. From the moment she walked into the theater, she was ready to roll her sleeves up and get busy. And while people were still coming into the theater and finding their seats, she was talking to them over the loud system, you know, hurry up. What are you doing? What's taking so long? I mean, she was ready and raring to go from the moment she walked in. KC and the Sunshine Band, I mean, they brought the house down. These are the songs you grew up listening to, and then all of a sudden, you're there in the presence of these great musicians. It's, you know, there's a story. I've got a story for everyone.
I do want to point out that diversity is also very important to you.
Yeah, well, absolutely. Look, how can you claim to serve the people if you aren't representing them? How can you do that? So certainly our acts are diversified. Our audience is diversified. Our staff is diversified. So, but that said, we don't cater to any one group. What we do is we produce world-class entertainment, and enthusiasts of the arts, well, they come.
I also should note, based on your location, you're a learning laboratory for college students. How so?
That's true. Of course, we are located on the beautiful campus of Queensborough Community College, and the theater offers a unique way to foster deeper learning for our students. They learn about community involvement, civic engagement, student engagement. So the students, what they do is they apply what they've learned in class in a practical setting. And they develop critical thinking skills because we have them act, if you will, in a consulting capacity for us. So of course we are a functioning not-for-profit business. And so they get to apply what they've learned in that capacity.
So obviously we've touched a little on this during the pandemic, many cultural institutions shifted to virtual programming. Talk a little about how you adapted, and then we're going to get to what I know listeners want to know, which is what's on the horizon.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, the pandemic, wow. Who could have been prepared for that? We did everything possible to sustain our daily operations, for our students and for the community. We completely overhauled our programming, and we learned how to deliver it remotely. We created what we call QPAC Live, which continues to be a live weekly entertainment broadcast where we can still deliver quality, diversified entertainment. And so that's been very nice. In fact, I've had to set up a studio in my apartment, so that we could be more effective on many levels. So naturally, there was new equipment had to be purchased. For example, I'm speaking to you right now on a microphone so that I could be better heard, and I hope that it's clear I hope that your viewers
are
hearing
it. And it is.
Oh, good, okay. So that, I mean, now if you ask me a question about microphones and routers and the speed of the routers, and well, I sound like I know what I'm talking about, but so that's what we did. We got busy. I like to say, if you can't count on the creatives to figure it out, who can you count on? So when we're thrown these curveballs, well, we just have to then figure it out. And it's interesting because I was so concerned about the seniors who really the success of our theater was built upon, their loyalty. And so I was very concerned with how we were going to serve them, because not all of them are fluent, if you will, in computer correspondence and so forth. So then we joined forces with QPTV, Queens Public Television, and I obtained my producer credentials with them so that we could take the shows that we were streaming and put them on QPTV so that our seniors would have access to those programs as well. So that's how we did it.
That's fantastic. Now let's get to the most exciting thing. You're stepping up in-person programming. You held a free Father's Day open air concert. Talk a little about what's on the horizon.
Okay. Well, right. You have to keep evolving. You can't just stay static. So yes, we actually will continue with our virtual programming. But during the summer and fall months, we will be taking our programs to the streets. And so we're offering these fabulous, fabulous drive-in concerts. And we're doing it at the Bay Terrace Shopping Center in Bayside, Queens, New York. And so what happens is each customer gets two spots. You pull in with your car and you get the spot next to your car. And so you can tailgate. So people pull in, they set up tables and chairs next to their car, they bring food. And what's also really lovely is that the restaurants in the shopping center, they're participating in this. So if you order food from any of those restaurants, they will deliver the food to your car. So it's really so much fun. And the cars sort of act as natural barriers. So you're in sort of your own little pod, which is nice. You could have as many people in your pod as you want. And you're picnicking, you're having food, and you're watching a fabulous concert. And we're pulling out all the stops. I mean, we have a fabulous, huge stage, fabulous sound equipment, LED screens. So it's just a super fun way to enjoy live music.
That is wonderful. Now, I also do want to point out, you've got some things on the horizon in July and August, such as Broadway's Rock of Ages band, the band. Yep. And that is on July 25th. Also, the Kings of Disco the Kings of Disco on Sunday, August 29th evening. Yep. And then Here Comes the Sun. I'm sure this is going to be a big one. The Music of the Beatles on September 17th. Any other details you want to provide about these that you want our listeners to know about?
Listen, great shows. I'm just thinking this. Oh, and this weekend, of course, we have the Soul Cruisers, which is a Motown show. We're trying to offer a lot of variety. The Broadway's Rock of Ages band, these are the guys who performed the show on Broadway. And so they're coming and they're going to, it's that 80s music. It's that really fun 80s music. And they'll be here, doing that. The Kings of Disco, here's a little secret. They're actually original band members of the Village People. So they can't call themselves the Village People, but the group consists of six amazingly talented performers, of which I think four of them are original Village People. We've got the original Army Sergeant and the original Navy guy and Ray, who's the lead, who plays the one in the Navy, right? You have the Navy and you have the Indian and you have, remember the construction worker. Right. So Ray is Valerie. Let me just think now. Oh my goodness. Simpson. I'm sorry. It's Ray Simpson. Ray is Valerie Simpson of Ashford and Simpson. Ray is Valerie Simpson's brother. And he's been the lead for the Village People in the Navy clothing, Navy costume forever. And so these guys will be there. So they'll be singing and performing a ton of disco hits, but they'll also be performing their classic songs, YMCA, in the Navy, all those songs.
I imagine these are going to be events that are going to sell out quickly. Tickets are available for them already?
Tickets are absolutely available. www.visitqpac, which is QPAC.org. www.visitqpac.org. Yep.
Now, I want to know, I'm talking about QPAC, but I really want to know your story. Let's talk for a moment about you, how you came to QPAC, just a little about you.
Okay, you'll need a little more time. I was born and raised in Queens. I'm a Queens girl through and through. So I care deeply about, what goes on in the community and in how to make, you know, just trying to sustain a certain quality of life. I care deeply about that because this is all I've ever known. I've been with QPAC for 17 years, which I cannot believe. It went by so quickly because, you know, we're always so focused on how to do it better and what's the next great thing that we could bring to the community. And so in all that planning, the years just sort of passed by. But the arts have always played a very significant role in my life. My family is very musical. And so, you know, this was, in a sense, my destiny.
And as I get ready to wrap up, please remind our listeners once again where they should go to learn more about the Queensborough Performing Arts Center and, of course, to get tickets.
Thank you so much. So we're very visible on the web, certainly our website, YouTube, just type in Queensborough Performing Arts Center. On Facebook and on Twitter and on Instagram, we are at Visit QPAC. And again, our website, it is active, and some wonderful programs will be going on sale. If they're not already on sale, will be going on sale very soon for the fall and beyond. www.visitqpac.org.
Susan Agin, thank you so much for appearing here on the It's in Queens podcast.
Thank you so much for having me. This has been terrific fun, and I look forward to speaking with you again.
That was Susan Agin, Executive and Artistic Director at the Queensborough Performing Arts Center. And as much as we talked about in-person events, when you check out their website, you'll see they've got virtual ones as well. And I do have to note, for anyone who wants to get there by car, they have free parking. Trust me, that's priceless. This podcast is brought to you each week by the Queens Economic Development Corporation and Queens Tourism Council. And each week, Rob Mackay, who serves as QEDC's Director of Public Relations, Marketing, and Tourism, brings us the scoop on some of the amazing events that are on the horizon in Queens. So this summer, he will bring you both the hottest and the coolest events. Here's this week's report.
Hi, Jeff. I'll try and be quick, although sometimes I say that and then blabber on forever. Anyway, what I want to do this time is just remind everyone and those who didn't listen to last week's podcast that the New York Hall of Science is opening on July 8th. It has a few new exhibitions and all the other great stuff that it's had for a long time. It's been a long COVID, and now they're back. And again, that's July 8th. I also wanted to talk about a carnival that's coming to town. It's going to be at both City Field and then Astoria Park. You can go at City Field from July 3rd to September 2nd. And if you miss that, or if you want to go again, it'll be at Astoria Park July 7th to 11th. So in all told, that's about 10 days of carnival, all kinds of rides. You know, there's the Dreamcatcher, the Skyhawk, the Wisdom Himalaya, the Dream Wheel, the Starship 3000, all those kinds of stuff. And so if it's back and it's outdoors, and it's a lot of fun already. I've got a lot of emails about it. And then July 4th, I'm also happy to say that fireworks are back. What is entitled Macy's Salutes Those Who Serve will be on July 4th and around dusk. You know, it's always, you got to wait till it gets dark out. In this case, there are going to be 5 barges on the East River, just west of Long Island City. And those barges are going to shoot about 65,000 shells and other effects into the sky for about 25 minutes. You'll see everything, you know, fountains, parachutes, sparkling waterfalls, aerial repeaters, and all those kinds of things. And you'll be able to watch it at a couple different places in Western Queens. Obviously, Gantry is the best. The places in Manhattan to watch it, you have to be able to prove that you've been vaccinated. But I think most Queens places, you don't have to. Those are some really good news, good things to do, fun, outdoors, summer-type stuff. Queens is back. Thanks, Jeff.
Don't you just love listening to Rob? That was Rob McKay of the Queen's Economic Development Corporation and Queen's Tourism Council. And as I've said, you gotta check out their website. There's so much more going on. If you want an easy way to keep tabs on all of it, the place to start is the Queen's Tourism Council's It's in Queens website. It'sinqueens.com. You can't forget that. You should also sign up for the Queen's Economic Development Corporation's newsletter at queensny.org. And of course, show your love for Queens. Remember, no matter where you are in Queens, tag us on Twitter. Use the hashtag #ItsInQueens or follow us at #ItsInQueens on Twitter. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons, and I'll be back soon with another episode of the It's in Queens podcast.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue, clouds of white, the bright, blessed day.